The initial examination of Nikita revealed that she and her associate Shantanu and Disha had created the toolkit Google document.
It is what this country stands for. It's about freedom of speech. It's about the right to criticize. It is about the right to protest peacefully.
इस तरीके का हम माहौल नहीं चाहते हैं अपने देश भर में कि कोई भी अपना आवाज़ उठाएगा तो उसको दबा दिया जाएगा. वो गलत है.
बहुत से लोग ऐसे हैं जो कि देश के अंदर बैठ करके देश में भारत की छवि कैसे खराब हो इसके षड्यंत्र साजिशों में लगे हुए हैं. उनमें से ये लोग हैं.
कौन सी वो दो लाइनें हैं? ऐसा क्या हुआ है बताएं तो सही. आपने अगर 21 साल की बिटिया को अरेस्ट कर लिया तो उन्होंने ऐसा क्या जघन्य अपराध कर दिया ये भी तो पता लगे.
हेलो एवरीवन, यू आर वाचिंग न्यूज एपिसेंटर विद मी मारिया शकील. In the wake of the January 26th violence, beyond the rioters and the instigators who indulged in violence and vandalism on that day, the Delhi police is probing the protest toolkit, which was disseminated online, a handbook on how to escalate the farmer agitation linked to Khalistani organizations and tweeted out by climate activist Greta Thunberg. Now a 21-year-old climate activist from Bengaluru named Disha Ravi has been taken into custody and charged with sedition and conspiracy for her link to the protest toolkit. The Delhi police are also searching for advocate and activist Nikita Jacob and a man named Shantanu in connection with this probe, claiming they are part of a wider conspiracy to instigate violence via the farmer agitation. In a press conference today, the cyber cell accused them of creating and editing the toolkit. They claim Disha sent it to Greta Thunberg via Telegram and created a WhatsApp group to spread the document. The Delhi police says all three of them were in contact with the pro-Khalistani group, the Poetic Justice Foundation, that is the PJF. The police says they had a Zoom call with members of the pro-Khalistani group in early January. Disha, on the other hand, has claimed that she only edited two lines of the Google document. Her aim was to show solidarity with the farmer protests and that she has no links whatsoever with any Khalistani group. The opposition is also up in arms, accusing the government of manufacturing villains in the wake of the Republic Day violence, claiming Disha and others are being targeted for supporting the agitating farmers. But Delhi police sources have also revealed that chats between Disha and Greta, where Disha said, and I quote her, "Our names are out, we can get UAPA against us," showing that she was aware of the gravity of her actions. Between the charge and counter charge, there is still a lot of evidence that is not in the public domain to flesh out the charges against Disha and the other alleged conspirators. Are we still far away from the truth of what role Disha and others actually played in the spread of this protest toolkit? Or is the opposition just for the sake of politics playing down a real plot to instigate violence? Is Disha Ravi just an activist caught in a political crossfire, or is she a real conspirator? Joining me on the show, Yashwardhan Azad is a former IPS officer, Sanju Verma is a national spokesperson of the BJP, Tara Krishnaswamy is author activist, Aman Panwar is the spokesperson of the Congress. Tara, I'm going to begin with you. Help us understand, what exactly is a toolkit? Is it for a select few? And on what basis is the access to it decided?
A toolkit is basically another way to say it's a set of instructions and tools. Hmm. So, for example, when you see a lot of people on Twitter, supporting a particular move of anyone's, for example, save trees or save a forest, or somebody does a great job in cricket, and you hail them. So those are common hashtags that are used. But if you're planning a campaign, then you provide a set of common hashtags to be used. The campaign can be anything from planting trees to supporting your team to
Tara, toolkits. The access to toolkit is given to a select few, it means, and the basis of that access is to those who are perhaps authors or
yes
those
no.
who
yes
are editors.
No. Yes and no. Okay. It depends. Access to the toolkit can be given to a large number of people if they are contributing towards the organization of something, right? Or contributing to further the cause as well. For example, you want a lot of suggestions from people as to creative hashtags, you can give a lot of people access. In fact, if you know anyone's email, you know the president of the US's email, you know the prime minister's email, you can add it to the toolkit. That means they have access. That doesn't mean they're culpable for anything, right? So the access to the toolkit, it's just a Google Doc, right? And the Google Doc says, where do you meet? Or what WhatsApp group do you join if you want to support a certain cause? Or what kind of hashtags you want to use? The notion that everybody uses a toolkit, the every political party's IT cell uses a toolkit. Every campaign organizer, whether it is tree plantation or a protest, uses a toolkit. It's just a fancy way of saying, here's a list of common instructions for all of us to follow so that we can act in a coordinated fashion.
Okay. That's I'm going to come to you about Disha and others in just a bit. Tara, let me get a quick word from Sanju. Sanju, the toolkit at the center of the case spreads basic information, as Tara was pointing out, on protests and suggests various online and offline protest modes, but doesn't necessarily have to incite violence, you know. So, at best, Disha can be treated as a dissenter against government policies. And why should dissent here be equivalent to sedition?
You know, Maria, I heard what Tara had to say, and I am absolutely shocked and also a wee bit amused. Nobody here is disputing that toolkit is a very effective means of communication in contemporary day and age. You know, political parties use it, social media influencers use it. Whether, you know, Disha Ravi had access to the toolkit or not, whether she was the one who authored the toolkit or not, whether she was the one who edited the toolkit or not, whether she was the one who formed the WhatsApp group which was responsible for the original Greta Thunberg toolkit and then, you know, subsequently deleted the WhatsApp post and then sent that original toolkit which had incendiary content via Telegram, all that is not the point of debate. The point of debate is this. That the content of the toolkit had clear instructions that from 1st of January 2021 up till 26th January 2021, tweet storms have to be sent defaming the Modi government, defaming the Yogi and Chai image of India. And remember what the toolkit said before it was pulled down. 250 farmers have been shot by the police. Go back and read the original toolkit.
So the charge here is that they instigated violence.
Not a single farmer lost his life because of a shootout by the police.
Okay.
That is there in the public domain.
Yes.
So when you post inflammatory content with an intent to defame India, do not normalize
anti-India
hate and
sedition. So has the Delhi police really built those linkages? Yashwardhan Azad will answer that.
Poetic Justice Yashwardhan Foundation, Azad, which has Disha Ravi in it. You
Yashwardhan
have to
stop. Here is, start.
Yes, Yashwardhan Azad. Here is Delhi police talking about timelines and making Disha, Nikita, Jacob, and Shantanu, and their linkages are being built. How they were part of some Zoom chats as well, in which all these modalities were being discussed. That is something I want to know. Do these online toolkit-driven campaign, are they so potent that it will lead to a violence as we saw on 26th?
Not normalized arson.
That's a very important issue which you have raised. But let me first come to the toolkit itself. You know, the toolkit per se is just a mechanism, right? And in this toolkit, the information so far received is that it articulates the reason for the farmer protest. It calls upon the you to contact your representatives. It calls upon you to protest at the various embassies. It calls upon for a Twitter storm and things like that. So basically, if you really look at it, it's a kind of a propaganda blitz. It's a kind of a mobilization to support the farmers' protest. Now, the issue is this propaganda is also being internationalized. So I'm not too sure whether this itself is legally tenable to hold them liable for sedition or disaffection. But there are two other things.
Yes.
One is that the toolkit has also links, gives links to the Khalistani literature, which is proscribed. Now, the thing is, whether these people, Disha, what's the Mensriya, was she in the knowledge of this fact that there is a proscribed literature to that toolkit? And that's why the Poetic Justice Foundation is already known to be an organization which was trying to disrupt. There were, you remember there were 350 Twitter handles which were suspended by Delhi police. And the last point which is important is, to be culpable, it would also be important to know whether that so-called Zoom meeting which they are talking about had this something incendiary, calling for to take arms on the 26th of January or things like that.
But then...
Otherwise, but then, in itself...
Yashwardhan Azad?
Yes.
Yashwardhan Azad, that toolkit does talk about organization. It does talk about a campaign. It does talk... You know, can we just stop it as by saying that it was just about a propaganda online, when it can lead to a very volatile situation offline as well, as we saw how it played out?
That's a very important point. You know why? Because even the Supreme Court in one of the rulings had said that for this kind of sedition to attack harmony and to break public tranquility, the action should be able to cause an imminent disruption, you know, and constitute that kind of a threat to the state. So while on one hand, I will certainly need more details on the basis of which Delhi police has instituted that case, they must be having.
At the moment, but what will be your reaction? Caution? Or will you be giving them a clean chit?
You know, I would say you need not have arrested them because there's nothing to recover. So why arrest them? I mean, you go ahead with and when it's the cast iron case, then you build it. Because as far as this is concerned, to consider that it was a threat to the state will be a little difficult to prove. But I'll await more information.
Yes. And also, Yashwardhan Azad, let's not forget that from 26th, when the actual violence, vandalism happened, till now, the Delhi police did take 20 days. So can this arrest not be seen as they having followed all the protocol, although a lot of questions have been raised, and I'm going to ask about how all the protocols have been violated in this particular arrest, because the procedure has established by law, lot of people and particularly the Campaign for Judicial Accountability and Reforms is saying. But before that, come in on this, Aman Panwar. You know, the reaction that comes from opposition is that this is some kind of thwarting freedom of speech and expression. But because the investigation is still going on, could there be a little more caution? I mean, look at a former cop. He is saying that Delhi police must be having enough evidence to do what it did.
See, the opposition is saying this, looking at the backtrack, looking at the past record of the government in power. And I must tell you, though sedition is the favorite legal position of the BJP to suppress the voice of the dissenters, between 2015 and 18, there were 191 sedition cases filed by the Modi government, out of which only 4 people were convicted. In 2019, as it was told to the parliament just 10 days ago, there were 93 cases of sedition filed by the BJP government, and they could secure conviction only in 2 cases. In more than 85% of sedition cases, the provision which the BJP has been using against the dissenters, they have not even filed charge sheet. So, I mean, this is their track record. So, I mean, this is appalling that the government now wants to use sedition as a legal force, as, a tool to suppress dissenting voice. And what happens when somebody like Arnab Goswami was leaking official secret information?
I will not allow you to take the name of another editor on this channel first. Yes, I'm going. Yes, Sanju.
Can I please rebut?
Sanju, this point being made here is essentially that the government loves to bring sedition charges against just about anybody who is dissenting. Anybody who doesn't, who is not in agreement, is. Okay. Slapped with these charges.
And I'm talking on basis of statistics, okay. NCRB data and the data.
Sanju, go ahead.
Okay, now can I please come in? Maria, I heard what Mr. Panwar had to say, and since he gave out statistics, I have some very interesting statistics for him. Let us not forget that the people who were charged and arrested for sedition between 2005 and 2011, when the Congress was in power at the center, are names like Simranjit Singh Mann, Arundhati Roy, Binayak Sen, Sudhir Dhawale, and cartoonist Aseem Trivedi. It was the Devendra Fadnavis government which finally released an innocent and innocuous cartoonist like Aseem Trivedi in October 2014. It is the Congress which tried to curb dissent via the First Amendment, via the 42nd Amendment, via the Anti-Defamation Bill, which Rajiv Gandhi wanted to pass in 1988. Thank God it did not go through. And that infamous 66A, do not forget about 66A. It was the BJP which said nothing doing. 66A encroaches on individual freedom of expression. We don't want to have it implemented. So please don't come and give a lecture to the BJP on freedom of speech and expression. The fact is that the Congress has come into the habit of losing elections and then second-guessing the bona fides of our investigative agencies. If the Joint Commissioner of Police, Prem Nath, has come on record and said that Nikita Jacob, Mo Dhaliwal, Greta Thunberg, Disha Ravi, Shantanu, these people are all involved and there is a clear link between these people, these elements and the Poetic Justice Foundation, there could be a PAF ISI element also. Why is it that we do not trust our police machinery? Why don't we trust our law and order machinery?
Tara and Yashwardhan Azad.
The qualifies of our investigative agencies.
Yes.
And the Congress waxing eloquent on freedom of speech. Excuse me, Mr. Panwar, where were you?
Yes, I'm going to come back to you. I'm going to come back to both of you. Talking about the politics of it. Yes.
Modern day Aurangzeb.
Okay. Aman Panwar, 10 seconds to you and then I'll bring the two activists and I'll start wrapping the debate.
Penguin.
Yes.
Do not
come
and give
fine
me a
enough.
Lecture
okay.
On the BJP
Aman.
And FOE.
Aman.
Just said that the Joint Commissioner has come out and has given the statement. Is the Joint Commissioner of Police the court? Is he acting as the judge, jury, prosecutor, everything? Now he has given the statement, it should be taken on face value. In 85% of your cases, sedition cases, you have not even filed charge sheet, madam, in the last 6 years. That is your track record. And you spoke about 66A. Let me tell you that your own government gave an affidavit in the Supreme Court, said, yes, we support this law. It was the Supreme Court.
Okay, Tara, now please.
I don't know which word are
Tara,
you bringing in.
Tara, since you are from Bengaluru, here are a lot of questions being raised. The fact that Disha wasn't represented by a counsel. Were the case diaries and arrest memo examined? A lot of questions have been raised about the entire procedure that has been followed. And she was, you know, without a transit remand, she was moved from Bangalore to Delhi. Now the question is, I want to know about the nature of her work.
Yeah.
You know,
so that's
in
the
sense
part,
that
right? she is an activist who has been working on, you know, environmental issues, lake issues, tree plantation. I don't know her personally, but anybody who's an active citizen in Bangalore has, you know, come across her work, if nothing else. And she has no priors or a criminal record. So, and in a digital world, you can be in a Zoom conference with hundreds of other people. You don't know who those hundreds of people are. You can even organize the conference. Things get shared. People join. Somebody who joins may happen to be a serial killer or a murderer. I don't know. It's for the court to determine whether Disha is involved or guilty, right? That's a, it is not for us to determine. The police is one side of the story. It is not all of the story. Disha is not here. Her counsel is not here to give their side of the story. So it's unfair of us to judge her without hearing that side of the story. So the issue is this. The issue is, if you suspect, if you as police suspect that somebody may be involved and they have no criminal record, no priors, you question them. Why wouldn't they intimate the Bangalore police? Why is there no place in Karnataka
to
question
them?
Is there no Bangalore magistrate to produce her in front of? Excuse me, I didn't interrupt anybody.
Go ahead.
I would really appreciate if I can finish.
Tara, finish your point. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. So are there no magistrates in Bangalore to question her? And why isn't her legal counsel present? And it is the same Fridays for Future who had posted an email in response to the Environmental Impact Assessment 2020, where they had said if anybody has an opposition to it, this was when it was published in 2020, and the government, Union government, asked for feedback on EIA 2020. The government had published an email, Environment Ministry. So FFF posted a note saying, here is how you can send email to the Environment Ministry. And numerous people sent email, and they were flooded with email, unfortunately.
No.
At that point, the Environment Minister sent an open letter, which is circulating, yes. Twitter circulated, saying,
Maria, trust where are we taking the debate to?
Sanju, listen to me first.
Are we under culpability?
My only point is, you have to say alleged. It has to be an alleged conspirator. You cannot brandish her and say that she's a conspirator till the time it is proven. It has not been proven, so you have to also say that she is an alleged conspirator. Go ahead, make your point.
Okay, Maria. Maria, let me come in and very clearly tell you a couple of things. No, because you know, when you talk about incidents where a Rinku Sharma is stabbed to death, you say alleged killers. But when it is a Kamlesh Tiwari, you never said that.
Come on this debate topic, please. Let's talk about Disha Ravi.
Right-wing goon Kamlesh
Tiwari. Talk about Disha Ravi.
So please do not teach me the difference.
Talk about Disha Ravi.
And whether it is bona fide or not to
talk about Disha Ravi.
Culpable. I will speak as I want to.
Yes.
Just like she has no business saying.
Talk about Disha Ravi.
You did not tell her that. Please say she could be allegedly innocent. Did you
talk about Disha Ravi?
Okay,
let me give the final words to Yashwardhan Azad. Yashwardhan Azad, the point being made here. The point being made here is that her arrest happens, questions being raised about the method that has been followed, what was the urgency, if she, you know, without a transit remand, she is moved states. All that aside, how can a toolkit be seen as such a big conspiracy, and is it legally tenable? This kind of arrest, what are the likely questions that the Delhi police can face in the court now?
Yeah, let me quickly stay on the facts and not the acrimony which was going on just now. See, the facts are that Disha is an enthusiast. She's an, you know, environmentalist, and she got a little excited. She wanted to contact Greta Thunberg, get that international acclaim and things like that. The point is that I would be very, very careful in instituting a sedition case straight away. You know, the police needed to question her. The police didn't need to arrest her. And only after building evidence, one of the evidence which can come across, if they have details of some kind of Zoom meeting,
which gives a point of view.
Sanju, you also got a fair amount of time to make your point. Let Yashwardhan Azad make his final view. Please go ahead, Mr. Azad.
Madam Sanju, I did not disturb you.
You did not. You have been going on interrupting me. The moment I make a point which is not in line with what you assume, you completely
take me off the screen. Mr. Azad, go ahead.
Which is unfair.
Mr. Azad, go ahead.
I think you don't want to listen to facts, Sanju, then it's a problem, right? I'm already saying that I would be very careful in instituting a case of sedition. I'm talking about facts here. I'm talking about chronology here. I'm talking about the incidents here. There are two facts which stand out. The link was to a proscribed literature, Khalistan. Now, Disha was unaware of it. She was obviously innocent. Can you say that her Minsriya stated that there should be an armed rebellion against the state? No way. You can't. So when one has to be a little balanced thinking about these things, and that's why I'm saying if Delhi police has some extra evidence, obviously they wouldn't like to divulge everything. But I would be careful in instituting a sedition case, because as you rightly said, Maria, at one point, that an action should lead to an imminent disturbance. You know, it's creating either disloyalty or a feeling of enmity against the state. That is the whole point, and that is why I said I would be a little careful. And yes, she should have been allowed a lawyer, and in the end, the arrest was not necessary.
But then when we look at the linkages, the fact that in that Zoom call, Mo Dhaliwal was present, as Delhi police is alleging, then will she be seen as culpable? Because he is someone who runs the Poetic Justice Foundation.
The question is whether that meeting actually resulted in the violence there. That means the Kisan Rally leaders had no role at all. And it's only because of those limited Khalistani elements that it's violence. This is unbelievable. So when you look at something, you have to take the evidence all together. Okay. And that is why it's a little too early to surmise on this issue.
Finally.
And that's why the sedition case should have been taken up later.
So great degree of caution being made by Yashwardhan Azad. Thank you so much. Always a pleasure to have you on my show. Tarak and Sanju and Aman Panwar, thank you so much for joining us. The debate on news18.com. That's all from me. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll be seeing you tomorrow.